Hello, I'm Bob Gourley. I'm the Chief Technology Officer of OODA LLC. This presentation is about the metaverse. Specifically, it's about security in the metaverse. How do we identify threats and then devise appropriate mitigation measures for those threats? I have a few slides I want to show you and then would like to invite your input. In this presentation, I'll give you my opinion of the five most fearsome threats in the metaverse and would love your input, comments, and questions. Here's my contact info. Reach me at bob@ooda.com. But I'm also on Discord. The presentation is going to dive into some information I think the security community can use to help improve metaverse security. It includes some background to metaverse, the ways that I characterize this new development. And then when we get into the threats, I give you my view of what the five most fearsome ones are. I propose a framework for improving defense and mitigating some measures that includes recommended actions for entities. Of course, I would love your input and feedback throughout this and would welcome your criticism, comments, and suggestions for ways we can continue to improve metaverse security, because frankly, things need to be done now. But let me give you the bottom line up front. I view the metaverse as a third major wave of internet technologies. And ask yourself, is there any reason to believe that the metaverse and its wave of technologies will be as secure as the previous two waves? It will not be as secure as the previous two waves. In fact, many threats will get worse. So clearly, there's need for more involvement by the security community. This approach of looking at the internet in three waves is a good way, I think, of orienting yourself to change. The first wave was when we were connecting all these computers together. It was the era of interoperable computers and servers. Email was the killer app. HTTP and web links came soon after that. It was the age of improving and dramatically enhancing e-commerce and web apps. It was primarily based on fixed line communications. The second wave was the mobile wave that included the proliferation of smartphones and the many apps that run on top of those smartphones, but also other mobile devices. Of course, all the devices from the first wave were still there, but because of both improved cellular data and Wi-Fi, there's new capabilities to be delivered to this mobile internet. That was the second wave. What's this third wave? The third wave is more of a shared, interoperable virtual world with a trust layer for store of value and an ability for users to persist across multiple environments. This is an ability not just to interact with the environment of the internet, but to be in the internet. What do I mean by this? Well, first, I want to say you will see a lot of definitions for the metaverse. I think it's far too early to expect a single definition of the metaverse. But we need to describe what we're talking about. So broadly, I consider the metaverse a massive, infinitely scalable shared virtual world where land, buildings, bots, avatars, and other property can be bought and sold and persist, and users can be there together. Think of it as the future convergence of all of today's virtual worlds interconnected with a single settlement layer for interoperable transactions of any sort. The metaverse will be accessible by billions via any web browser, not just the 3D devices, not just virtual reality and augmented reality, but via any device. We're seeing hints of the metaverse today, but I do not believe we will see the true metaverse for another decade. What hints are we seeing of the coming metaverse? Well, there's a lot of business collaboration and remote work tools that are just totally relevant to this kind of a metaverse experience and are giving us hints of what's coming. The way Zoom took off over the last 2 years is giving us a hint at what can happen in virtual collaborative environments for education. There's a lot of great gaming environments that show what it's like when multiple people can be in one environment. Roblox and Fortnite are just a couple. There are so many others. There are limits to all of these. They're not interoperable together, and they're also limited in size and scale. There's also some open environments based on Web3 technologies like Decentraland, which is extremely scalable and gives a store of value that can be removed from those lands. So these two are showing hints at what's coming soon. Pokemon Go is one that shows what the coming metaverse may be like when it comes to augmented reality, because it is absolutely something that all of us are able to do via mobile devices and shows the connection between the physical world and the virtual world. Digital twins also show the connection between the physical world and the virtual world. Digital twins are taking off in industry and in government as a way to understand flows in complex systems and then take actions to improve things and to make assessments before you make a big change. Digital twins are definitely showing us a hint at what's coming. The great devices like Oculus Rift, of course, but also HoloLens and Magic Leap are also giving us hints at the coming age of AR, VR, and the metaverse. The Web3 trust layer that's being established by extremely credible projects like Ethereum are showing us what a trust layer based on interoperable cryptocurrencies may look like. There's also many other use cases we're seeing that are giving us hints at the coming metaverse, remote medicine being a key one that's driving some of this. But the metaverse is not here yet. What will the metaverse be like and when will it be here? If you consider the metaverse as being this future network of interconnected technologies that's building upon the existing internet, when will we have this shared, persistent ability to interact with everyone at the same time? I believe, frankly, this is decades away. I believe it's coming, and we will continue to see improvement, but the real metaverse could be decades away. That said, it looks like it's already on path to be a $1 trillion industry, and every individual company is now should be considering a metaverse strategy. IT firms are investing in it now. And money is being made, which means it's going to get traction. This means, of course, we, the security community, need to pay attention to this. When it comes to definitions of what's real in the metaverse, I really like the approach of Matthew Ball, who runs an investment firm which focuses on metaverse technologies. He breaks the metaverse into these categories because it's easier to track and quantify and understand where investments flow. I think it's also a good logical way of thinking about security in the metaverse. If you look at these major categories, every one of these are going to need security layers in order to really improve the metaverse security. So what do we need to protect the metaverse from? I've categorized what I believe are the five key metaverse threats, the most serious ones, in my opinion. Would love your comments on this. Definitely would appreciate any feedback you can give. So let's talk about these five. The first is new privacy threats. This is a threat today with today's technology. As we add the metaverse, it gets even worse. There are privacy threats due to surveillance by corporations, of course, by criminal groups, hostile nations, fraudsters and other criminals. And already we all have a digital life online. We, I think, in the security community are aware of that. So many others are not. And this online presence is at risk. Now imagine being in a metaverse, the metaverse, where you're being watched 24/7, 365. And imagine this metaverse and the many sensors observing what you desire and capturing that. It's truly a privacy threat. The next category of mass languor, I wanted to describe the danger of pulling people from reality in two ways. One is the exciting pull of the super realistic simulations and games that give us this feedback that keep pulling us in. The maximum dopamine drive of your brain is going to keep us going towards the metaverse, and it will contribute, I'm afraid, to mental weaknesses. Now, this directly relates to the next threat, the Oneirophrenia, This is described as the state of one when one loses their ability to determine what's real and what's not. This makes understanding what is misinformation and disinformation even harder. Now, I mentioned the privacy threats, and the privacy threats are bad on their own, but the privacy threats also directly contribute to new fraud vectors. Companies and communities want to build and maintain trust with good people. And there's so many good people out there, but there's also the fraudsters and the hucksters and the grifters, and they will come where your digital value is. And this is a key threat. The last one I called unleashing demons. And this is something that concerns me today. The worst of human nature being revealed on today's internet. Imagine a virtual metaverse of just a few years from now, when anybody can be anyone and do all sorts of things and demonstrate some of their worst demons. It's a true threat. And the threat of cyberbullying is just one way of expressing this. There are so many other bad demons that I think will be unleashed, and they will all be coming at us with persistence. Now, there's things we can do about all of these threats, but some of them actually get really hard to solve. And there's clearly a need for your input and ideas and suggestions on how we tackle these kind of threats. The only thing I can think of is that we, the security community, keep doing what we've been doing in the past, which is work together to exchange information on the threat and solutions for the threat. I think we can work together better if we leverage a framework where our conceptual solutions can be applied to reducing risk based on the entities in this framework. The entities in the framework that I described to you are listed here. There's individuals, us, what do we do? There's communities, many of which we are in and operate in, but there are many others. There's companies that are building stuff, governments and academia. Everybody should have a role. So let me list a couple of high-level recommendations for each of these categories. For example, we as individuals, every individual in the metaverse should understand some security fundamentals and privacy best practices. It's your privacy. You need to understand how to protect it. There are things to learn. And the same is true with crypto wallets. How are you going to protect your store of value in the metaverse? We also need to understand the strengths and weaknesses of pseudo-anonymity in the metaverse and how to maintain pseudo-anonymous accounts to protect individual privacy. We also need to understand what our expectations are for our communities, for governments, and for corporations. As an individual, what do you want communities, governments, and corporations to do to reduce risk? Turn your desires into requirements. I think that's very important. It's also important to be self-educated and know before you go. When it comes to some of these threats, though, some of the threats can only be defeated by your own personal self-discipline. This is hard, but self-discipline is extremely important in mitigating this threat of mass languor. It's also important that all of us continue to work on our critical thinking as a way of defeating fraudsters and hucksters and other threats. These are things individuals should do. Would love your comment on this and inputs. There's also things at the community level that can be done. There's a lot of communities already building things in the metaverse. I consider the DEFCON ARVR Village an extremely important community, but this community is one that's built up of security practitioners and people who already know the issues. There's a lot of other communities out there, all of which will have some role in mitigating risk. One of the hardest challenges for communities, I think, is that communities need to find ways to limit bullying. Not just bullying, but also fraud and other issues like manipulation and misogyny. Now, doing this, it's easy to say and sometimes hard to do. You need to involve users and ensure that there's a strong feedback from your community to make sure you're doing it in the right way. And you also need, we need to do this in a way that continues to build value for the community and does it in a way that mitigates risk early. We can, as communities, work to build in security at the beginning instead of tacking it on later. We can also provide education to the community on what acceptable behavior is. And communities also should work to audit their own presence on the metaverse to continue to mitigate risk. Respecting privacy is also extremely important, but you know, this runs contrary to the threat of Oneirophrenia. How do you know if someone is just totally detaching in a way that's harmful to them and society? What can companies do? Oh, there's so many things that companies should be doing right now to build security in. And I think one of the key first things they can do, all companies, is to build in ways to improve privacy. That's extremely important. And this kind of thing, if it's built in at the beginning, is so much easier. The protecting our privacy is something that all of us want, all of our communities want, and we should express this to companies and make sure they know this is what we want. I think we all understand the importance of testing security and privacy, and that means red teaming. Companies should also work with users and communities and governments and academia to find ways to mitigate these threats to privacy and reduce the ability of criminals to operate overall. When it comes to governments, there are some things that only governments can do. Governments can facilitate information sharing. Governments can also find ways to track and mitigate hostile intelligence services in the metaverse. Really, the government's the only one who can really do this at scale. The government should also find the right role for law enforcement in the metaverse. There's definitely a role for law enforcement in the metaverse, but we also don't want law enforcement to transition into a threat to what we want. So it requires some balance here. We want our governments in open societies to stay on the side of people, of human rights and privacy. When it comes to academia, there's a lot for academia to do to improve their use of the metaverse, but also to teach new frameworks, new security, and new ways to protect privacy. Academia can also help ensure that the metaverse is being built with security in mind. These are all just some high-level recommendations. The key recommendation is that let's, as a security community, start more of a dialogue. I'm so excited about the AR/VR Village at DEF CON, because what a fantastic way to dialogue, not just at DEF CON, but continuously through the year. As we do that, we can build our requirements for the metaverse and articulate them in ways that others can use and improve their own security posture. Those are key recommendations. Would love your thoughts on any of this. And I really just wanted to leave you with one closing thought. This thought from Claude Shannon. I think this applied in his day, and it applies in the age of the metaverse. The metaverse is being built. Why would any of us not assume that the enemy is not going to be there? In this case, the adversary is definitely going to be there. We just need to assume that. Thank you. If you want to reach out to me, I'm at bob@ooda.com. I will also be at the AR/VR Village at DEF CON and at the on the Discord server.